I'm Rose, and this is what the CDC calls a Biosafety Level 3 laboratory, where we study all the scariest, most lethal, most face-melting diseases ever known to man in the pitiful hopes that we can learn just enough to keep the human race from being entirely eradicated. Now, this place might sound like it's perpetually one broken beaker away from unleashing undead zombies or sentient clouds of Ebola, but actually, remember the Black Death, the medieval disease that once reduced the world population by at least 20%? We actually work with those very bacteria because, unpleasant surprise, the disease is still around and kicking people to death. In 2015, 16 Americans were infected with bubonic plague, and 4 of them actually died. That being said, the plague is actually pretty easy to treat. We have to go on antibiotics whenever working with live bubonic plague bacteria, but other than that, we really don't sweat it.
You're it!
And while we wouldn't recommend playing used needle tag, with the amount of treatment and research available, we actually aren't even that worried about working with HIV. So what disease really terrifies us? Tuberculosis.
But not just any old tuberculosis, a new drug-resistant kind. Think classic Little House on the Prairie-style consumption. You know, the leading cause of death in America around the turn of the 20th century. Only now, we're wearing a medicine-proof Kevlar vest and are immune to most standard anti-TB treatments. About 30% of antimicrobial resistant deaths around the world are now all me, baby. And with a mortality rate as high as 39% in some cases, I'm making a comeback.
Some of my colleagues who work on HIV think we'll roll back the tide on the disease in the next 10 years, while TB will continue to be a huge problem for maybe ever. Totally drug-resistant TB is such a scary idea. They don't even want you to say its name. Like, it's Voldemort. Oh no. Hey, while you're here, would you like to see our glowing green cock? Let me back up a little. We have a really neat piece of equipment called an in vivo imager, which is essentially an ultra-sensitive camera. We can tag viruses or bacteria with glowing proteins, inject them into animals, and pop the animals in the imager to see in their bodies where the germs go. We had a glowing plague strain and a glowing monkeypox, and with the in vivo imager, you could watch the natural course of the diseases just tearing through the animals. One time I was conducting experiments on pox viruses, the things that cause giant pimples, I was trying to metaphorically beat them up with the baseball bat of science until they became docile enough to become vaccine carriers. But I wasn't sure that the rehabilitated vaccine viruses would work. My supervisor suggested we use the in vivo imager to at least see if the pox virus would work in chickens. We used a marker strain of the pox virus that had a luminescent gene, and then used the imager to capture tiny amounts of light from the luminescent viruses through the flesh. Which is just a fancy way of saying that, as far as I know, I'm the first person in the world to take pictures of a glow-in-the-dark chicken. Now I'm just waiting to hear back from KFC about my idea for the lantern bucket. Oh, and on the subject of animals, at any given time, there are enough dead critters at a biosafety level 3 lab to completely fill the freezer section of Noah's Ark. Our freezer was always full of botulism-infested dead ducks and tilapia from the Salton Sea. We also had a ton of prairie dogs for a monkeypox experiment delivered to us from an exterminator who removes them humanely but hilariously with a giant vacuum cleaner that literally sucks them out of their burrows. Don't worry, ethics rules dictate it would be too cruel to let any animal die of any disease. I mean, it still isn't great, but once they're too sick to move or they lose more than 20% of their body weight, we put animals to sleep. But also, yeah, we definitely infected voles with chronic wasting disease and finches with the West Nile virus. And another time we got sent a bunch of mice from a researcher who had made a plague vaccine out of genetically modified tomatoes. None of the mice survived, and we never even found out if it was because the tomato vaccine didn't work or because the mice were too old or something. The point is, if animals ever rise up against humanity, scientists at Biosafety Level 3 labs are totally screwed. A day at a Biosafety Level 3 laboratory is essentially an 8-hour game of the floor is lava. Except that everything is lava, and the lava is microbial death. You try to get through the entire day without touching anything because it might be contaminated. And if you do accidentally touch something, you have to change gloves immediately. Weirdly, while we do spend most of the day covering ourselves in more latex than Motley Crue groupies, we also spend an unexpected amount of time with our clothes off. No, not like that.
Ah, come on, baby.
At one lab I worked in, each gender had a locker room on the clean side and a locker room on the dirty side, connected by a one-way airlock going in and a shower coming out. We had to strip on the clean side, go through the airlock, then put on scrubs in the dirty locker room. Exiting, you would dump your scrubs in a laundry basket on the dirty side and immediately shower so as not to let a single speck of possibly contaminated material through. This has led to more than a few accidental flashings. One day, I accidentally opened the airlock door on my boss's full-ass nakedness, but unlike your job, nobody here really thinks twice about dangling bits, because there's nothing like being killed by an invisible death to help your mind disconnect nudity from sex. Oh, and if you're wondering what happens to our contaminated scrubs? Don't worry, thanks to all the precautions, you could use them as baby mattress stuffing. Chances are it's cleaner than anything you have in your house. In fact, you probably should use scrubs for your mattresses. The animals demand it.